What's up, designers, and welcome back to Rempton Games. Today, I'm very excited to present part 5 of the Evolution of Pokemon Design series, this time focusing on Pokemon Black and White. This generation has the most new Pokemon, is one of the biggest conceptual shifts in the series, and is also one of the most controversial generations so far, so I've got a lot to talk about. Really quickly, however, before I get into that, I want to briefly comment on another one of my recent videos, on how I taught an AI to play Pokemon Emerald. I was overwhelmed by the response to that video, with many people expressing interest in seeing more with that project. I just want to let everyone know that I do hear you, and I do plan to do more with this project, possibly even putting up pure gameplay videos in the future to see how far the AI can make it on its own. However, just know that this is a complicated project, and I have a lot of other things in the pipeline, so it's not going to be right away. More is on its way, but it might take a while, so stay tuned. With that out of the way, let's jump into Generation 5. As I mentioned before, Generation 5 is a very interesting generation because it represents a bit of a shift in focus for the series. In an Iwata Asks interview, Junichi Masuda explains that the development team was very nervous about designing Black and White because this would be the first time that a new generation was developed on the same hardware as the previous generation. Up until this point, every new generation has been on a new piece of hardware. Red and Green on the original Game Boy, Gold and Silver on the Game Boy Color, Ruby and Sapphire on the Game Boy Advance, and Diamond and Pearl on the Nintendo DS. This change in hardware created an inherent distinction between each generation. However, this time there was no change in hardware, and the team was worried that unless they deliberately shook things up, the games would end up feeling too similar to the previous generation. This attitude towards designing these games resulted in a number of changes beginning in this generation. This can be seen perhaps most obviously with the choice of region. All four previous regions, Kanto, Johto, Hoenn, and Sinnoh, were all based on different parts of Japan. On the other hand, this new generation's region, Unova, is based on New York City in the United States. Choosing to base a region on the United States had a number of ripple effects on the design. First, it resulted in the creation of a number of Pokemon with American influences, such as Braviary, the bald eagle Pokemon, LGM being based on the Roswell aliens, Bouffalant the bison, Sigilyph being based on Native American artwork and the Nazca lines, and Maractus being based on cactuses found in the American Southwest. Although this region draws inspiration from many different parts of America, it's still primarily based on New York, and for this reason it's one of the most urbanized regions and has the biggest city seen so far, Castellia City. Because of this, many Pokemon designs in this generation have an urban influence, such as Watchog being based on a crossing guard, the P-Dove line being based on pigeons, the Conkeldurr line being influenced by construction workers, as well as Pokemon like Garbodor, Vanilluxe, and Scrafty all making sense in an urban environment. Choosing to make a region set outside of Japan also had a number of other effects on the design. One of these was an emphasis on diversity. Japan's population is very not diverse. According to a 2018 census, Japan's population is 97.8% ethnically Japanese. The United States is much more ethnically diverse, with large populations of people from European, African, Asian, Native American, and South American descent. Because of this, these games have a much more diverse set of human characters than previous generations, with characters such as Iris, Marshall, Lenora, Alder, and Marlin clearly not belonging to the light-skinned race of generic anime people. The focus on diversity doesn't seem to have had too much of an effect on the designs of Pokemon in this generation, with one huge exception. Each of the starter Pokemon of this generation actually represent a different cultural background, with Superior being based on European nobles, Emboar being designed like an ancient Chinese warlord, and Samurott, of course, representing a medieval Japanese samurai. The last and most impactful consequence of choosing to set a region outside of Japan was the distance to the previous regions. In the previous generations, it was totally normal to walk around and find Pokemon that are native to other regions. However, as a way to show just how far the Unova region is from the previous four, Game Freak made the decision that you wouldn't find any Pokemon from previous generations in the wild until after you beat the game. This decision had a huge influence on the direction of the game and brought it very close to reboot status. The decision not to include any Pokemon from previous generations very strongly influenced what Pokemon they had to design this time around. For the very first time, for example, this generation doesn't include any Pokemon that are evolutions or pre-evolutions of previous Pokemon. This means that certain designs that may have initially been related to previous generations, such as Lovedisc evolving into Alomamola or Tauros turning into Buffalant, ended up being turned into their own single-stage Pokemon. This decision also caused the team to design Pokemon that fill roles that are eerily similar to Pokemon from the past. While certain types of Pokemon, such as starters and cover legendaries, are repeated pretty much every generation, Gen 5 gets much more specific than that. For example, in previous generations, you could occasionally find a Pokeball on the ground, pick it up, and it turns out to actually be a Voltorb. This is very similar to the classic idea of a mimic chest that's found in a large number of RPGs. Because the team decided not to include any older Pokemon this time around, they created a new mimic Pokemon, Fungus, to serve this same role. Similarly, in the anime, Chansey and Blissey are often shown assisting Nurse Joyce at Pokemon centers. This generation needed a new Pokemon to fill that role, so Audino was born. Woobat and Swoobat were designed to fill the role of bats that you can find in caves instead of Zubat, while Roggenrola replaces Geodude in those same caves. You have a fighting type duo with contrasting fighting styles, a three-stage fighting line that evolves by trading, a psychic dream-based Tapir, and I could keep going. All of these designs are clear callbacks to Pokemon from Generation 1, and are meant to fill a role that was left vacant by the lack of older Pokemon. The decision not to include any older Pokemon also put restrictions on the elemental types that could be included. This generation had to stand on its own, which meant that it had to have enough Pokemon of each different type. This led to several Pokemon changing types to create a better variety. Stunfisk, for example, was originally a water electric type, but got changed to electric ground. Similarly, the Frillish line was originally pure water, but the ghost type got added during balancing. While being based in the US certainly had a huge influence on the design of these games, that wasn't the only thing they had going for them. Pokemon Black and White also had the thematic motif of opposites working together, and truth versus ideals. This can be seen most clearly when looking at the cover legendaries of these games. Pokemon White gets the black legendary Zekrom, while Pokemon Black gets the white legendary Reshiram. This also connects with the origin of these Pokemon in the lore of the games. According to legend, there were two brothers who used an ancient dragon Pokemon to create the Unova region. However, these brothers soon came into conflict, because one strived for truth while the other fought for his ideals. In response to this conflict, the ancient dragon split into two, Reshiram and Zekrom. Reshiram, representing truth and yang, sided with the older brother, while Zekrom, representing ideals and yin, sided with the younger brother. The leftover empty shell of the original dragon became the ice dragon Kyurem, which represents the concept of Wuji, the absence of yin and yang. The concept of opposites also shows up in other places in the game. Certain locations, such as Opelucid City, will have a more advanced technological appearance in Black version, and a more ancient rustic appearance in Pokemon White. There are also exclusive locations in each version. Black City, of course, is exclusive to Black, and White Forest is exclusive to White. Unfortunately, this theme doesn't really seem to show up in the designs of the Pokemon, aside from the aforementioned legendaries. Even the version-exclusive counterparts, Mandibuzz vs. Braviary or Reuniclus vs. Gothitelle, don't really seem to play up the theme of opposites any more than version-exclusives from previous generations. aside from these themes, there were a number of technological and mechanical advances that had an effect on the designs of these Pokémon. The first of these is the addition of in-game seasons that change every month. This mechanic hasn't come back in any generation since, but it is responsible for the design of one Pokémon family, Deerling and Sawsbuck. These Pokémon are both grass normal types and have four different forms based on the current season. Characters in the game often influence the design of certain Pokémon, such as Volcarona specifically being designed to be the champion's ace, but Black and White has a very interesting example of this. The first gym you'll encounter in Black and White is very unusual because it actually has three different gym leaders, Cress, Salon, and Chili, that specialize in the elements of water, grass, and fire, respectively. Which one you face will depend on which starter Pokémon you picked. You'll always face the gym leader whose element is super effective against yours. The three monkey Pokémon, Panpour, Pansage, and Panseer, were specifically designed to be used with these three gym leaders in order to support this gimmick. The way Pokémon were displayed in this generation also changed significantly from Gen 4. Although these games were on the same hardware as Diamond and Pearl, they not only found a way to increase the size of each sprite, from 80x80 pixels to 96x96, but each Pokémon is also continuously animated. I think we've started to hit the point where the increase in the size of the sprite will have diminishing returns on what types of Pokémon can be designed, but the continuous animation did somewhat expand the types of Pokémon that could be created. Kling Klang's design, of gears constantly turning together, really needs to be seen in motion to work. Similarly, Scrafty's animation really helps drive home the idea that it's wearing saggy pants made of its own shed skin, and Reuniclus's animation makes it seem more transparent, something that would not come across as clearly in a static sprite. Other designs, such as Kofagrigus and Cubchu, maybe didn't strictly need animation to work, but it really helps sell the design and personality of these Pokémon. Now it's time to look at some design trends in this generation that don't necessarily fit into any of the above categories. I will say that Gen 5 is particularly difficult to characterize in terms of an overall style, for a number of reasons. First, it introduces more Pokémon than any other generation, so for any trend that you try to point out, you'll have a large number of counterexamples that don't fit with that trend. In addition, Gen 5 had more artists working on it than any other previous generation, which means more people are putting their own unique spins on Pokémon designs. That being said, I do think there is one major trend that characterizes this generation as a whole, and that's the willingness to make Pokémon designs that are weird, goofy, and bizarre. For the first time since Gen 1, we get Pokémon with multiple heads like Vanilluxe and Hydreigon, or multiple bodies like Kling Klang. We also get goofy designs like Stunfisk, which was specifically designed to be the flattest Pokémon, Trubbish, which is a derpy bag of trash, and Sigilyph, which is still quite possibly the strangest Pokémon design ever made. It may also be helpful to note some of the trends that Gen 5 didn't carry over from Generation 4. First is the lack of random or unnecessary spikes in the designs. It's not that none of these Pokémon have spikes, it's just that they seem more integrated into the designs of Pokémon like Ponyard, Ferrothorn, and Gigalith, rather than simply pasted on like Rampardos or Lucario. Similarly, while the designs of Pokémon in this generation aren't necessarily less busy than in Gen 4, I think that the extra details tie in more closely with the concept of the Pokémon. They feel less extraneous. Because of this, I feel like there are very few Pokémon in this generation that feel over-designed. The big, glaring exceptions to this are the cover legendaries of the sequels, Kyurem White and Kyurem Black. Just looking at these Pokémon visually, it's clear that they have a lot going on, but I think they're also trying to do too much from a conceptual level. These designs each represent Kyurem fused with either Reshiram or Zekrom, so clearly the design wants to represent the different parts of the fusion. However, it also wants to convey a sense of incompleteness, since the fused dragon is still missing a piece, and the designs also try to convey that this fusion is unnatural due to the artificial nature of the fusion. That's a lot to try to convey in a creature design, and ends up leaving the end result feeling extremely cluttered. Although one could argue that this is intentional. Finally, I just want to briefly touch on some of the controversy around the designs of this generation. There have been claims for a while among certain members of the Pokemon fandom that Game Freak is running out of ideas for Pokemon, and I think that this idea started, or at least really picked up traction, around the release of Pokemon Black and White. Some designs in this generation, such as the Vanillite family, Trubbish, Stunfisk, Klingklang, and the Three Monkeys, were very unpopular when these games were first released and were put forth as evidence for the idea that Game Freak was running out of ideas. While I don't personally think Game Freak will run out of ideas anytime soon, I do think some of this criticism is valid. With the three monkey Pokemon, their evolutions, as well as the legendary genies Tornadus, Thundurus, and Landorus, this shows that the designers of this generation were willing to release Pokemon that were basically palette-swapped versions of each other. On the one hand, this is something that pretty much every other RPG with monsters does. For example, a game like Dragon Quest might turn their slime a different color to show that it is a little bit stronger now. However, I think we've come to expect more from Pokemon and expect each design to be more unique. On the other hand, I don't have a problem with many of the other Pokemon that were listed. Garbodor, for example, is a being made of trash. He's a replacement for Muk, a first-gen Pokemon made of toxic sludge. I see no reason why, in the Pokemon world we have been presented, a Pokemon made of trash, or that simply resembles trash, wouldn't make sense. True, it looks a bit derpy, but derpy Pokemon have been around forever as well. Similarly, nobody really seems to like Klingklang since it's just a bunch of gears. True, but I think gears are underappreciated. You can make some really cool things out of gears, such as mechanical computers, and Klingklang actually makes use of a wide variety of different types of fun gears, like Sun and Planet and Bevel gears. So yes, the design may just look like a bunch of gears, but as before, I see no reason why that can't be a Pokemon. That being said, this generation does contain what I consider to be the worst, laziest Pokemon design in the entire series. Place your bets on who I could be referring to. Drumroll, please. It's Basculin. Sorry if you're a Basculin fan, but I think it is an awful design, and here's why. First, it reminds me way too much of Carvana. But I would say that Carvana is more interesting because not only is it a water and dark type instead of just pure water, but it also evolves into a shark. Basculin, on the other hand, is a single stage Pokemon with below average stats. Basculin was also only designed because there was a shortage of fish Pokemon in this generation. However, not only was it added basically as an afterthought, but it was also given two different forms that barely differ at all, purely as a way to increase the number of different fish that could be caught. That being said, with a generation as big as this one, you're sure to have some misses, and I actually think that overall, this is one of the most creative generations so far. But what do you think? Are there any other major trends that I missed that I should have talked about? Do you strongly disagree with me about Basculin or any of the other Pokemon that I mentioned? Let me know in the comments down below. That's all I have for this week. If you like this video, please give it a like and subscribe so you don't miss more videos like this in the future. If you want to see more, you should definitely check out the previous entries in this series, as well as my other videos on a wide variety of different game design topics. And join me next week where I dig into the religious symbolism that can be found in the Halo series. Until then, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you all next time.